So what is the second most common cause of death in lupus? The second most common cause of death in lupus is actually infections. And the reason that I go over these really bad things that can happen is that you're not going to know what to do for your lupus unless you know what bad things can happen. And infections are one of the things that you can actually prevent and treat. So number one is, if you ever get a fever, don't just think it's due to your lupus and ignore it. You need to make sure that it's not an infection. So we do recommend that lupus patients, when you get a fever, don't just write it out and hope that it goes away. You need to call up and see your primary care doctor right away and make sure that it's not truly an infection. Also, if it's an evening or if it's a weekend or a holiday, please consider going to an urgent care center to make sure that it's not an infection and get it treated. Secret number 11, please get the flu shot every single fall. We can't tell people enough how important this is. 20,000 to 50,000 Americans die every single flu season from complications of the flu. The vast majority of them are very young, they're very old, and people with bad immune systems like people with systemic lupus. And it's very easy to do, and it's such a totally preventable thing. Secret number 12, if you're on immunosuppressant medications, please get the pneumonia shots. When we look at the types of infections that people get with systemic lupus and when they're taking immunosuppressants, pneumonia is the number one cause of death. And the nice thing is that there's two vaccinations out there that will help prevent this. And by the way, this is not just a secret for you possibly, this is a secret from your doctors. Most doctors don't know about this second vaccination, so it's really important that you bring it up to them. These are the list of immunosuppressant medicines. They are in your handout. If you're on any of these, it's really important to get your pneumonia shots. The first pneumonia shot is the Pneumovax, and most doctors do know about the Pneumovax. You should get two vaccinations 5 years apart from each other, and then a third one when you reach the age of 65 years old. But there's a second pneumonia shot that most doctors don't realize that lupus patients should get, and the reason for this is that this is a new recommendation from the Centers for Disease Control. The name of the pneumonia shot is called the Prevnar PCV13. A couple of good things about it is, number one, it's a lifelong vaccine, so once you get it once, you never need to get it again. Number two, it protects you against 13 different strains of pneumococcal pneumonia, which is the most common cause of pneumonia. But the timing has to be really perfect with this vaccination. It's a little complicated. If you've already had the Pneumovax, it's really important that you wait an entire year at least before you get the Prevnar. And if you're getting the Prevnar first, it's important to wait at least 8 weeks before you get the Pneumovax. And you will have to bring this up to your doctor, because most rheumatologists don't realize that this is a new recommendation. By the way, most doctor's offices don't give this. Usually I have to give my patients a prescription and have them take it to their pharmacist to get the vaccine at the pharmacy. Don't go to CVS, don't go to Rite Aid, don't go to Walgreens. They do a bad job. I've had the wrong pneumonia shot given to my patients. But for some reason, the grocery store pharmacies do really well. So in our area, it's Safeway and Giant. They've done an excellent job. And it has to be refrigerated. I think that's why, because they have more refrigeration at those other pharmacies. So this the next slides are for 26 years olds, patients and less. So everybody else can cover their ears. This doesn't apply to people over the age of 26. Unfortunately, human papillomavirus occurs more often in lupus. Studies show that when patients are first diagnosed with systemic lupus, that more people have been exposed or infected with HPV, human papillomavirus, which is a sexually transmitted disease, than people who do not have lupus. And we don't know why that is. It might have something to do with the altered immune system. In addition, patients with lupus, when they have HPV infection, have higher rates of cancers related to those particular HPV viruses. The cancers that we see more often include things such as vaginal cancer, throat cancer, non-melanoma skin cancers, and the other ones are listed up here. And the good thing is that three of these strains can be vaccinated against with the Gardasil vaccine. And so we do recommend that patients who are 26 years of age or less, that they should get the three series Gardasil vaccine. I mean, this is actually a vaccine that can actually prevent cancer from happening. And even if you've been infected with HPV before, if you've had a cervical exam and been found to have HPV, we still recommend getting the Gardasil, because there's many different strains of HPV, and this does protect you against three of them. Next, cancer is the fourth leading cause of death in lupus, so again, it's an important thing to prevent. I'm preaching to the choir, but we know that lupus is very expensive. You're seeing a lot of doctors, you're getting a lot of tests done. And because of that, unfortunately, lupus patients don't do very well at cancer screenings. Studies actually show that lupus patients do worse than most patient groups. And I think it is because we have you so busy doing everything else. But it's very important to make sure you keep up on top of your mammograms and your colonoscopies and everything else. A new recommendation this past year, smokers should get a CAT scan of the lungs once a year. They actually showed lower death rates in smokers when lung cancer was caught at an earlier stage. So consider asking your doctor for a CAT scan on a yearly basis if you're a heavy smoker now or have been in the past. Vitamin D. Vitamin D deficiency has been found to be a trigger for systemic lupus, and this has a very interesting story. Over the past decade, we first started to see that lupus patients had lower vitamin D levels than people who don't have lupus. And we thought, well, maybe it's because the sun makes them sick, they stay inside. The way that we naturally get vitamin D, by the way, is that our skin manufactures vitamin D because of sun exposure. So it just made sense, well, maybe lupus patients are not going outside and they're low in vitamin D. But then we found that the sickest lupus patients had the lowest vitamin D levels. So it actually correlated with disease severity. And then they looked at flares of lupus. Patients who were doing fine and then would flare up, they checked their vitamin D levels. The patients who flared and had the worst flares had the lowest vitamin D levels. You know how we check the complement levels and the double-stranded DNA levels because they fluctuate with disease activity? This one particular study found that a low vitamin D level was just as predictive of a flare as double-stranded DNA and complement levels. So then Johns Hopkins did a really nice study last year. What they did is they took over 1,000 of their systemic lupus patients in the lupus cohort group up at Johns Hopkins. And what they did is they identified those who had a vitamin D level less than 40. They put them on once a week ergocalciferol, which is this prescription strength vitamin D. And they also had them take a calcium tablet twice a day that also had vitamin D in it as well. Then they followed them for 2.5 years. And then at the end of 2.5 years, they looked at their disease activity compared to patients who did not have or whose vitamin D levels did not go up by a certain amount. They looked at the ones whose vitamin D levels went up by 20 nanograms per milliliter, and they found that those patients actually had less disease activity. In fact, it was so significant that the patients with lupus nephritis, there was actually less proteinuria or less protein in the urine. It's very hard for us to prove that medicines work for treating lupus nephritis or kidney inflammation, and here a simple vitamin D supplement was showing that it actually helped out with lupus kidney disease. So not only do lupus patients have vitamin D deficiency more often, but it actually getting the vitamin D level up can actually help treat your lupus. So everybody should have their vitamin D level checked. If it's less than 40, go on a vitamin D supplement. This is lifelong therapy, by the way. And then have your level checked 3 months later. If it's not 40 or above, go on a higher dose and just keep asking for a higher dose until you get to 40 or above. Very easy thing to do and very safe. So secret number 16, if you take steroids at all, if you're not on a medication to prevent osteoporosis or broken bones, please ask your doctor about it. Unfortunately, osteoporosis and broken bones is a common complication in people who have lupus, and not enough of our patients are taking medicines to prevent that from happening. So if you just happen to be one of those patients where that hasn't been caught by your doctor and you're on steroids for a long time, please ask them about medicines to prevent broken bones. Very preventable. Secret number 17, if you've been on steroids for any significant amount of time, you may have a condition called adrenal insufficiency. The adrenal glands are two very small glands that sit on top of the kidneys, and they actually make steroids every day. They make around 5 to 7 milligrams of prednisone on a daily basis. But when you take prednisone or steroids all the time, the adrenal glands shut down. And the problem with that is that we need more steroids during times of stress. If we get an infection or we get surgery, our bodies actually make up to 20 milligrams of prednisone per day just to get us through the stress. And so if you've been on steroids a long time, your own adrenal glands can't do that for you, and you need to get extra steroids. So if you show up at the emergency room real sick, the doctors and nurses need to know to give you extra steroids. Or if you ever get an infection, does it ever seem like it lasts longer than other people? A lot of times that can be due to adrenal insufficiency from not having enough steroids. So it can be actually beneficial to take some extra steroids for those stress doses if you've been on prednisone a long time to help get you through an infection even. Secret number 18, make sure to take your medicines regularly. Sounds like such an easy, simple thing and straightforward thing. But unfortunately, we know that 50% of our patients do not take their medicines regularly. It's been borne out in way too many studies, especially Plaquenil. Plaquenil, only 50% of our patients take their Plaquenil regularly. And that's just so sad because it's the safest medicine that we have to treat lupus, and it just sets the person up for failure in the long run. The number one cause of lupus flares and doing poorly is not being compliant with medications and the other things that we're asking you to do. So please figure out how to take those medicines regularly. Secret number 19, keep a medication list, an updated medication list. I see this every single day in my clinic where I think the patient is taking their medicines one way, but they're actually taking it a different way. It's so confusing. They're getting so many different medicines from so many different doctors, and there's old prescriptions that have different recommendations or dosing guidelines compared to the newer prescriptions I might have wrote for them. And the problem is that when the nurse takes the medication list and they just run through the medicines real quickly, oftentimes the patient will just say yes, 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 and not really hear what the nurse is asking them. I highly recommend that you keep your own medication list, have the names of the medicines, the milligrams, how many you take at a time, how often, and then when the nurse asks you what medicines you're taking, don't even answer the question, just hand the list to him or her, and that way we can know 100% what you're taking, because I see too many incorrect medication lists, and that can be a setup for failure and not doing well. So this is 1973, this is the first mobile phone. Molly, can I have you come up here for me? Yeah, this is a Martin Cooper in 1973. That's been a long time ago. I just want to know if you can take a selfie with me. Okay. You know, selfies are the big thing in the past couple years, right? So this is just for me and Molly. There you go. We got it. There you go. Thank you, Molly. Appreciate that. Doctors like to do selfies also, you know. This is what radiologist selfies look like, by the way. I guess this is what they do when they're have some free time, right, when they're bored. Actually, this has nothing to do with my talk, but the studies show that by this time in the talk, two-thirds of you have your mind wandering. Some of you are thinking about what you're going to have for dinner or who's coming over to the house tomorrow. So I just want to draw everybody back in and get you back into the talk because I got some important things to talk about. Okay, so secret number 20, all patients with lupus should be on an anti-malarial medication. Plaquenil, chloroquine, or quinacrine. These are by far the safest medicines for systemic lupus. The only reason you should not be taking these is if you're actually allergic to them or if you've had a severe reaction of some type to them. The benefits of antimalarials are just amazing. Patients live longer. Patients are less likely to get severe internal organ damage compared to those who do not take them. They actually make the stronger medicines work better. Johns Hopkins did a study where they took patients with severe kidney disease. Half of them, they had to take their chemotherapy called Celcept. The other half, they had them take Celcept plus Plaquenil. Very safe, weak medicine. You wouldn't think it would do very much. Twice as many patients went into remission when they took Plaquenil along with their Celcept. So it makes the stronger medicines even work better. So even though you're on a strong medicine for your lupus, still please take the Plaquenil along with it. It also helps our pregnant women have babies. Women with lupus, if they take their Plaquenil throughout pregnancy, they're much more likely to have a good pregnancy outcome. It also decreases blood clots. Those 30 to 50% of patients who are antiphospholipid antibody positive and can get blood clots, it greatly decreases the risk of getting the blood clots in the first place. In fact, Plaquenil is so important to take that Dr. Michelle Petrie at Johns Hopkins, she's actually made this statement, hydroxychloroquine, which is Plaquenil, should be put into the water supply of people who have lupus. And most rheumatologists feel the same way. Plaquenil can, unfortunately, potentially cause eye problems. Back in the old days, when we used very high doses of Plaquenil, it would deposit into the retina or the back of the eye and could cause some permanent eye problems. And so there are some measures you can take to prevent this from happening in the first place, and I want to give you those recommendations. One thing is to get an ampullar grid. It's very easy to just download off of the internet and just stick it up somewhere and just look at it once a month. And all you have to do is cover up one eye and then you look at the center dot, and all the lines should be easy to see without any waves or anything or missing parts of that answer grid. And then you should do the same with the other eye. If all the lines are not clear, or if they're wavy at all, then you should see your ophthalmologist right away and get evaluated and find out what's going on. By the way, the vast majority of the time it is not due to Plaquenil, but it's still a good screening test for Plaquenil anyways. Most of the time it's due to something else like cataracts or diabetes or high blood pressure, or these days macular degeneration, which is due to the aging process. But still a good thing, easy thing to do for you to do at home. And I'd recommend doing it about once a month. How many of you are on 400 milligrams a day of Plaquenil? Most of you are on too high of a dose. People who are less than 5'7" tall should be on 300 milligrams a day of Plaquenil. And this is a new dosing recommendation, by the way. Most rheumatologists are also not employing this yet because most of them don't know about it. It's such an important issue, by the way, that Lupus Now from the magazine of the Lupus Foundation, they just came out with a really nice article about the eye problems from Plaquenil, and they actually stressed this in the article that Plaquenil needs to be dosed correctly. So if you're less than 5'7", we actually recommend 300 milligrams a day of Plaquenil. The reason for this is back in the old days, everyone used 400 milligrams a day of Plaquenil. Now we're starting to see eye problems from Plaquenil, and those patients who have the eye problems are those who take more than 6.5 milligrams per kilogram on a daily basis. But this is based upon ideal body weight, not true body weight. The problem is that Plaquenil is not absorbed into fat at all. It's only absorbed into the lean tissues of the body. And so you have to think about ideal body weight, which is based upon height. And so the dosing recommendations are as I have up here, and they are in your handout as well. I'd recommend you take a look at them, and if you're on too high of a dose, I'd recommend you point it out to your rheumatologist and ask them about it. And they probably don't know about it, by the way, but it's an important thing to have that discussion with them. Also use the ampullar grid monthly. See your eye doctor yearly. And by the way, getting the right eye exams are very important, and many patients are not getting the right eye examinations. When you see your eye doctor for your Plaquenil screenings, make sure that they're doing a visual field 10-2 test. Now, there's other visual field tests that are not nearly as sensitive for Plaquenil problems. And then they should also do a test called OCT or FAF, which are listed up on the screen there. Too many patients are seeing optometrists or other eye doctors that don't know the new recommendations. And these particular tests are the most sensitive tests on picking up any Plaquenil problems. We can actually pick it up way before the patient ends up having any permanent vision problems. Okay, most people know that the sun is bad for lupus. And so why is the sun bad for lupus? It's all because of ultraviolet light. The sun is the major source of ultraviolet light. And when ultraviolet light contacts the skin, it contacts the cells, which are just right underneath the skin there. The cells actually become damaged because of ultraviolet light exposure. That's why we even get the wrinkles and the sunburn and the aging marks as we get older, is because of all that repetitive sun damage over time. But those cells, when they get damaged by ultraviolet light, they extrude their nucleus and their proteins that are inside the nucleus. And guess what lupus does? Lupus has all those anti-nuclear antibodies. That's why we call it anti-nuclear antibodies. Lupus makes all these antibodies that actually recognize the proteins from inside of the nucleus of our cells, and it causes the lupus immune system to become more active, and the lupus becomes active in the kidneys and in the heart and in the lungs and in the skin and in the joints because of this ultraviolet damage. And by the way, even though 30-40% of patients, only 30-40% actually get the sun-sensitive rash from sun exposure, every single lupus patient will have triggering other lupus because of ultraviolet light. So this does pertain to all lupus patients. But the immune system of lupus with the anti-nuclear antibodies recognizes those proteins from the damaged skin cells, and that causes more lupus activity. I think most of us can easily understand being out on the beach, right next to the water, sun high in the sky. Even just 5 minutes of this can be very dangerous with a lot of ultraviolet activity. 15 minutes is a lot worse, and all of us can understand how an hour in the sun would be horrible for a lupus patient. But it's not just the sun. All these lights in here, in fact, these are probably the bad ones, but indoor lighting also gives off ultraviolet light. And the dosing of ultraviolet radiation to the skin has to do with the amount that you're getting at a time and then the length of time over time. So even though indoor lighting may have a much smaller amount of ultraviolet light compared to the sun, when you look at getting it all day long, that's a lot of ultraviolet damage to the cells of the skin. And so the bottom line is that patients with lupus should be wearing sunscreen religiously every single day, even if you don't go outside, because you're getting lupus activity in your body just simply from the lights in here. And by the way, there's a reason I put the compact fluorescent light on there. Great for the environment, right? You know, they're much better than the older incandescent lights. But guess what? They're higher in ultraviolet radiation. So these are actually bad for people who have systemic lupus. If you have fluorescent lighting, you should be using ultraviolet screens over them. But even a lot better is the newer LED lights, the ones that last for 20 years or so. A little bit more expensive, but there's a lot of them that are actually ultraviolet free, and that's what I use in my house. Is I use the UV-free LED lights instead. So as far as protecting yourself from ultraviolet light, there's a lot of rules to go by. They are in your handout. Some very important ones is always use sunscreen every day, even if you don't go outside. Make sure you use sunscreen that's good against UVA and UVB rays as well. And go by all the ultraviolet protection device that I put into the handout. Another good one is RIT SunGuard. Clothing like this only has an SPF of about 5, but there's something called RIT SunGuard. You can add this powder to your wash, and the SPF of the clothing is raised to around 30. And you only have to use it like a few times a year with your clothing to increase the SPF of your clothing. This is Joshua Kratchik. Does anybody here watch the X Factor? I do. I love reality TV. But he was on there a few years ago, and he was one of the runners-up. And he came to our lupus gala in Washington, D.C. a couple years ago. And he was there because his mom, her name is Lisa Pym, she actually has systemic lupus. And he made a very interesting comment. He said, "The only thing that lupus has done good for my mom is that it's kept her young-looking." Look how young she is. She looks like his sister more than his mom. But he said, because of the sunscreen she uses and because of not being allowed to smoke cigarettes, she looks young. And that's true. Those are two very important things for keeping young, is not smoking and not staying out of the sun and using sunscreen regularly. Secret number 23, do not eat alfalfa sprouts or mung bean sprouts. Both of these contain an amino acid called L-cannabinine, and it actually is one of the triggers for lupus. In fact, they had an environmental Baltimore study, and they actually showed that that people who were eating more alfalfa sprouts and mung bean sprouts actually had a higher incidence of developing systemic lupus. Include foods in your diet that are high in omega-3 fatty acids. There are some food studies in lupus patients that actually showed that patients who ate diets that were higher in omega-3 fatty acids had less disease activity when they were on those types of diets. These are just some of the foods that are high in concentrations of omega-3 fatty acids. The fatty fishes from cold waters like mackerel and salmon are very high. Walnuts is I think it's the nut that has the highest amount of omega-3 fatty acids in it. And then flax seeds. I drink 1 to 3 protein shakes every day, and I put flaxseed in my protein shakes. It actually has the highest concentration of omega-3 fatty acids than any other food, and it gives like a little nuttiness to my shakes. In fact, if you go to youtube.com, just put in my name, Donald Thomas, and lupus shake, you'll see how I make my daily shake rich in omega-3 fatty acids. And by the way, don't take supplements. Every single supplement, or the important supplement studies have shown that taking fish oil capsules, flaxseed capsules, omega-3 fatty acid capsules, you're wasting your money. The studies show negative results. In fact, just this past week, the Journal of the American Medical Association showed another study that was negative, and an editorial was put out in there by some very good cardiologists, and they said people just need to stop taking these supplements, and we even need to even just stop doing studies on it, because there's been over 2,000 studies on omega-3 fatty acid supplements that show that they are not beneficial. So don't waste your money. Instead, go to the store, buy some fish, buy some walnuts. In fact, I go to Costco, I just buy huge bags of walnuts, and I just, you know, have a handful every day. Oh, also, I put on there olive oil. There was actually a study that showed they had patients have 1.5 tablespoons of olive oil every day. They actually had less disease activity from their lupus. So include olive oil also in your diet. Secret number 25, don't take echinacea. Anything that says that it will boost the immune system, that's bad. I mean, lupus is a disease where the immune system is overactive already. Anything that's going to boost it and make it more active is not good for your lupus. In the Johns Hopkins cohort, they actually had a few patients that were taking a lot of echinacea. They actually ended up having severe lupus nephritis and went on chemotherapy because of it. So do not take echinacea. In fact, it's just better not to take any. Most supplements really have not been proven to be beneficial for most things, so it's really important to show your doctor any supplements you're taking anyways. Next is DHEA. This is a supplement that actually is beneficial for lupus. There's been studies that show that it does decrease disease activity for mild to moderate lupus. Systemic lupus, if there's a lot of fatigue and the lupus disease is active, it can help out with the fatigue. It can decrease the need for steroids or prednisone, and it also improves bone density as well. In fact, there's also studies that show there was a decreased amount of breast cancer in one of the lupus studies when they looked at the efficacy of DHEA. The recommended dosage is 200 milligrams a day. Please don't buy it over the counter, though, because studies show that 85% of DHEA supplements are poor quality supplements. Unfortunately, the FDA does not regulate our supplements and vitamins, so you really have no idea what you're really buying out there. But the good news is that the FDA has approved a prescription form of DHEA. It's called Prestera. If you go to Prestera.com, you can read all about it. It's a great resource. It goes over a lot of the studies that shows the efficacy. It's not available yet. I did talk to one of the representatives from the pharmaceutical company, and he said that in about 6 to 8 weeks, it probably will be ready. It does require a prescription, 200 milligram capsules once a day. Secret number 27, decrease stress in your life. And most of you probably already know this, I'm preaching to the choir, but stress can and does increase lupus activity. There's been quite a few studies to show that. One interesting study, they actually found a gene that where people were born with this gene mutation, they make less serotonin and norepinephrine. And those are also the things that are absent, by the way, in people who have depression and fibromyalgia even. But also those people have more difficult time tolerating stress. And they showed in this one study that patients who had that particular gene abnormality, when they underwent stress, they had more flares of their lupus, to include lupus nephritis. So it's really important to learn how to decrease stress in your life, and there's absolutely things that you can do to do that. Most of us have too much on our plate. Learn to say no. Too much of us do too many things that really are not that important in our life. And so I did put in a table in the handout that has some stress reduction technique recommendations. Secret number 28, you're already doing it, by the way, is self-education. My patients who really educate themselves, they really do better in the long run because they tend to be my most compliant patients. So please do things like joining Molly's Fund. The blog on there is incredibly good. They have some great medically sound articles about lupus and how to help out with lupus. There's also a journal. If you're not signed up for this, definitely do so. Most medical journals, we have to pay hundreds of dollars a year just for each journal as a physician. But there's a new one that just came out that's free for everyone called Lupus Science and Medicine. And this is going to only have lupus articles in it. the way that they're able to do this is that the researchers actually have to pay $3,000 to the journal to have it published. And so the rest of us, we don't have to pay for it, but we get it for free. But if you go to this website and then click on email alerts, every time there's new articles, they'll go ahead and send you an email alert, and you can actually read the entire article yourself. And it's a very good journal. They've already come out with their first few articles. It's run by the British Medical Journal in conjunction with the Lupus Foundation of America. And Jill Bayan, who's a rheumatologist who is originally at Johns Hopkins and now is at Columbia in New York City, she's one of the editors also, so it's really excellent. I have a Facebook page called the Lupus Encyclopedia. I put on tips and facts about lupus every day. So if you go to Lupus Encyclopedia on Facebook and click like, yeah, you'll find out when I put new facts and tips on there on a daily basis. And then also you can follow me on Twitter where I send out Twitter notifications when I put out new facts and tips. So I'll finish my talk with the Greek myth of Pandora. Pandora was the first woman who was created by the gods, and she was given many gifts. One of those gifts or attributes was curiosity. They gave her a box, and they said, Pandora, do not open this box. Well, of course, Pandora had to open that box. And to her surprise, she unleashed all the evils and pestilences and all the diseases into the world, which greatly troubled her. And she was very shamed about it. After all the evils and the diseases had left the box, she looked down into the box, and there was one item that was still remaining inside of the box. That item was a butterfly. It was a beautiful butterfly, and the name of the butterfly was Hope. Every 2 years, lupus experts from around the world, we meet in a different part of the world at something called the International Lupus Congress. And the lupus experts at the Lupus Congress recommend that when we look at the symbol for lupus, which is the butterfly, don't think of the butterfly rash that lupus causes on the face. Instead, think of Pandora's butterfly called Hope. Just like the ugly caterpillar can transform itself into this beautiful butterfly through hope, the person who is battling this ugly disease called lupus, you can change and transform yourself through hope into a better person as well. It reminds me of the story of Nick Cannon. Do you guys know about Nick Cannon, the celebrity? He's the MC on America's Got Talent, hip-hop artist, great comedian. But Nick Cannon, a couple years ago, was stricken with severe lupus. He developed lupus nephritis, where it attacked his kidneys, and developed blood clots as well. Nick Cannon went on chemotherapy, high-dose prednisone, and blood clots. And if you notice, he's still up on America's Got Talent. He looks incredibly healthy. He actually videotaped and documented his journey with lupus, and he showed that instead of giving into the disease and instead of just taking the medicines, he forced himself to exercise more, he forced himself to eat a better diet, he forced himself to get 8 hours of sleep every night, he forced himself to get rid of the stress in his life, and it's really a beautiful documentation that he videotaped for YouTube. He was our grand marshal for the lupus walk in Washington, D.C. just a few weeks ago called the Walk to End Lupus. And he gave a really moving speech where he got up and he talked to his fellow lupies. And he said, I am now in better shape than I've ever been in my entire life because of lupus. Because of lupus, I've actually started to take care of myself better, and I'm in better health than I was even before lupus hit me. So just like Nick Cannon transformed himself, and the caterpillar gets transformed into that beautiful butterfly, I hope that each and every one of you can take away some of the information that I gave you today. In fact, take home this handout called The Lupus Secrets, and I hope and I really encourage you to read this over, circle the things on there that you didn't realize you should be doing on a daily basis, and really make it a part of your life. I hope that each and every one of you can learn how to control lupus rather than letting lupus control you. And thank you.